أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم I welcome you to the series on signs from Allah history science and the soul in Islam I'm Dr. Nazir Ahmed and it's my privilege to be the host for this series Inshallah, what I hope to do is to present perhaps 10 sessions focusing on critical moments in Islamic history. I'm particularly pleased we have a few young people here, and I will try to bring the presentation down so that the young people also will get something out of it. This is not an ordinary series in history. Normally, people in this present history, they talk about who did what to whom, and when, and how. No, this is not the session for that. What we'll talk about is history as a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Very important point. History as a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We live in extraordinary times. These are times when human progress is limited only by the speed of light and the human capacity to absorb change. These are extraordinary times. These are also extraordinary times because the Muslim community is under intense pressure all around the globe. Historical forces, cultural forces, religious forces have coalesced, have come together to make this age an extraordinary age. Briefly, I'd like to introduce you to how this series on Islamic history and culture came about. It's a very good story for the young people. It was way back about 25 years ago. I was a professor at the University of New Mexico. And I had a friend in New York, Muhammad Munim. And he was running a weekly magazine out of New York City called the Minaret Magazine. Very good friend, he called me up and he said, Nazir, you're going to write a series on Islamic history and science. So I said to him, look, I'm a scientist and you're asking me to write a series on Islamic history. He said to me, well, if you don't write it, who's going to do it? So I started to write over a period of 3 years, between 1993 and 1996. They were published, extremely popular. Unfortunately, he passed on later. May God bless him. I want to give him credit for making this series happen. Later on, the series was translated into Urdu. It was published in India. In English, it was published by the Suhail Academy in Lahore, Pakistan. And a Farsi translation has recently been made by Brother Mujaddid. Just wanted to show them to you. Those who wish to look at it in the Farsi language, here's the Farsi translation available from Brother Mujaddid, who is a part of our congregation. And the books are available from Amazon.com if you're interested in buying the books. However, you don't have to spend money because most of this information is available on the internet. I put it up almost 15 years ago under historyofislam.com. And it has been visited by more than 2 million people around the globe. It's been very popular. People have benefited from it. Except for a couple of countries in Central Africa. That's by way of introduction. Now, for the sake of young people, you ask yourself, why study history? Why study history? When we study the Quran, you see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presents examples from people who came before us, starting with the histories of the prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us something about the history of Adam alayhi salam, Noah and Nuh alayhi salam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salam, Isa alayhi salam, and we know the history of our own prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's history in a broad sense. Secondly, the Quran also presents the histories of people who came before us as lessons to learn from. Something from the people of Noah, something from the people of the Pharaohs, something from the Jewish people, and something from the Christian people. So in that sense, Jewish history and Christian history becomes our teacher. It's a very important point. Look upon the history of the Jews and the history of the Christians as lessons to learn from. Not to look down upon other people, but to learn from them. What were the travails? What were the difficulties faced by the Jews? What were the errors made by other people in the past? So that we can learn from it. And of course, we make our own errors too. These are important considerations. The Quran teaches us, Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Sanurihim ayatina fil afaq wa fi anfusihim hatta yatabayyana lahumul haqq. I will show them my signs, S-I-G-N-S, signs on the horizon and within their own selves, within their own nafs, until it is clear to them that it is the truth. Therefore, history takes on a sacred character in Islam, as does science. Because signs on the horizon means signs in nature and signs in human history. We learn from those signs. Those signs are there so that we can learn from them. Nature is out there so that we can learn from them. Nature. Science takes on a sacred character. I'm using the word sacred because there is no better word in the English language. It's not a good word, but I'm using it to illustrate the fact that unlike modern science, which considers science to be secular and devoid of the grace of God, Islam considers signs to be a sign, S-I-G-N, from Allah. So that it is mandatory, it is required on the part of all of us to study those signs, to ask, يَسْأَلُهُ مَنْ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ هُوَ فِي شَانٍ. Everything between the heavens and the earth asks of him, and Allah gives when you study the Quran. Therefore, another very important point, I'll present some important ideas for the young people so that you remember it. You cannot understand Islamic history unless you have studied the Quran. I repeat, you cannot understand Islamic history unless you have studied the Quran. So, my dear young people, make it a habit. Make Quran your friend. If you know Arabic, that's good. If you don't know Arabic, get a good translation. One of the translations that is available to you in the center is this one. Of course, there are many other translations. Study the Quran. Because through it, the criteria that are offered to the Quran have been used by Muslims throughout centuries to justify what they did. As an example, even Timurlane, who is considered one of the greatest destroyers in the early part of the 15th century, the latter part of the 14th century, one of the greatest destroyers of civilizations, even he made sure that before he started on a campaign, he asked his ulama to give a fatwa saying that what he was doing was in consonance with, consistent with the Quran. All the movements that have taken place, every single one of them, even to this day, are justified or not justified in view of the Quran. Very important. Therefore, start with the Quran. Remember that history is a sign. Remember that science is a sign. And remember also the sciences of the soul, what is within ourselves, what we call tasawwuf, is also a sign within ourselves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put those signs within ourselves so that through those signs, which act like arrows, we embark on a journey to get to His presence. And life is nothing but a journey from the cradle to the grave so that we find Him. Life is a journey to find Him. We meet Him anyway. Upon our death, upon the day of, we meet Him anyway. So remember that. It is a journey. And everything that has been created and given to us as the Khalifatul Earth, as a representative on Earth, is a sign. Please remember those things. History has a sign, which is very different from who did what to whom, who conquered which territory, what happened, how much wealth did he gather. Those are not important. You ask yourself, why did they do it? What were the reasons behind it? What enabled some people to work together to achieve great things? And what enabled some people to fall apart? Why did they fall apart? Those are the lessons from the Quran. Those are the things that we must remember. And those are the lessons that we are hopefully going to focus on in this series. If you are a student of history, and indeed if you are a student of science also, you will find that history does not move in a straight line. Not every day. Things happen. It is like a river that comes across bends. History has major events, major bends. And these bends happen because of great ideas, great people, great events, cataclysmic events because of the acts of nature. These are bends through which we can have a grasp of the enormous, gigantic struggle of man on this earth. Otherwise, you will get lost in the details. Focus on the bends. Focus on the important events. So the first major bend in Islamic history was the passing away of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first major event in Islamic history was the passing away of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Remember, our Prophet was at once a prophet. He was the focus of all social, political, military, cultural, all these events, all the different aspects of a community. He was the architect of Islamic civilization. He was the pole, the axis around which Islamic civilization revolved. So when he passes away, what happens now? People ask themselves, how do we now continue the grand venture of Islam without the Prophet? Remember, the grand venture of Islam is based upon two major poles, if you will. The Quran, which is the basis, and the Sunnah of the Prophet. When the Prophet goes away, he has passed on. How does the community continue the implementation of what he had taught in the process of history? Remember also, why is the Islamic community here? Rather than say the Christian community or Jewish community or some other community. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it clear, kuntum خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lays down the reasons for the existence of the Islamic community. You are the noble ummah. Ummah does not mean the way we understand it. Ummah means a spiritual state. For instance, Ibrahim alayhi salam was an ummah of one. He was an ummah of one. The Jewish people constituted ummah because that represents a certain stage in the development of human civilization. The Christian people represented ummah because they represent a certain stage in the development of human civilization. And the Islamic ummah represents the completion of God's favor to humankind, and they represent a certain stage in the development of human civilization. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I created you, the best of ummah, for what purpose? Enjoining what is good, forbidding what is evil, and believing Allah. So how is this community going to continue the process of building such a virtuous community in the matrix of history without the Prophet himself, who was the architect of the civilization? In the answers to these questions lie the keys to understanding some of the difficulties that we face even today. The keys, for instance, to the Shia-Sunni split, the keys to the process of ijma, the keys to the process of evolution of the schools of fiqh, the keys to the process of understanding the importance of the sunnah. Because the way the Sahaba, the earliest of the Muslims, interpreted and acted upon the teachings of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam soon after his death, laid the foundation for Islamic history. That event brought into the process of history, covering, inshallah, we'll stop here. Immediately after prayer, we'll come back. And I hope to be done by about 8:15, 8:20. In between, there will be time, inshallah. Imagine you lived at the time and he has just passed away. That is what the Sahaba went through. History is a measure of the strength of a civilization. Civilizations are tested with crises, just as individuals are tested with crises. Great civilizations overcome their challenges and go on to attain higher altitudes. Lesser civilizations recoil and they disappear. That's one way to look at the difference between a great civilization and a civilization that is not so great. Similarly, individuals. One of the differences between ordinary people and great people is the following. Whereas ordinary people shrivel and recoil and cannot overcome the challenges that they face in life, great people overcome the challenges and go on to attain greater heights. For instance, later we'll talk about how Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu was a great man, how he met the challenges that was faced by the Islamic civilization and laid the foundation of what was to come later. We must remember that. So now, going back to the way things were upon the death of the Prophet, people could not believe it. The first reaction was to deny it. People were milling around, you can imagine, a small community in the bazaar, and rumors are flying, well, did you hear that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has passed away? That's the way news used to spread those days. And here comes Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, as you know, was a man of steel. He was a tall, strong man, given to speaking his mind exactly what was on his mind. A solid iconoclast, meaning he was a muwahhid. He believed the unity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more so, if we may say so, than some other people. So he comes into the marketplace and he hears these rumors and he gets very upset. And he makes the announcement. I hear some munafiqun, hypocrites, are spreading the rumor that the Prophet has passed away. By Allah, he has not passed away. He has gone to meet the Lord just as Musa alayhi salam went to meet the Lord for 40 days and he will come back. And Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu goes on and he says, anyone who perpetrates this rumor will have his hands and his legs cut off by the sword. Of course, everybody was afraid of him. And he continues this way. And then comes into this gathering, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, a man who rose to the challenge of the time. He sees what is going on. He hears the speech, the talk that Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu is giving. So he goes inside because, remember, he was family because his daughter was married to the Prophet, so he could go inside. Confirms that the Prophet ﷺ has indeed passed away. Then comes out and recites the ayah from the Quran, wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Muhammad is but a messenger. I'm paraphrasing in here. Look it up in the Quran. Muhammad is but a messenger. If he were to die or be slain, would you then go back on your belief, on your faith? If you go back on your faith, you do no harm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because he is self-sufficient. But if you do believe in him, then Allah is most forgiving. I'm paraphrasing. Look it up in the Quran. When people heard this message from Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, it's as if a big event had fallen upon them. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu is reported to have said that when he heard this ayah from the lips of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, it's as if he had heard it for the first time and his legs shook. Mighty man, because he realizes that the Prophet has indeed passed away. So now begins the process of Islamic history. The Prophet ﷺ leaves no instructions as to how to select, elect, nominate his successor. And I'll ask you later as to what the wisdom is in that decision. It was a very wise decision. A very grand decision, very deep decision. There is a mystery behind it. I'll also ask you also, why do you think the Prophet ﷺ did not leave behind clear instructions of succession, wisdom behind it? And now it's left to the Sahaba to create the edifice of Islamic history in the matrix of human affairs, to continue the process that had begun with our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Immediately you can see there are differences of opinion. And we started by saying that history is a sign, and I'll ask you at the end, what signs do you see in the passing away of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and in how the Sahaba tackled the issues facing them immediately after the passing away of our Prophet. I'll ask you that question. What are the signs? So there are differences of opinion. The Ansar, the people of Medina, who had welcomed the Prophet, and the people of Mecca, upon the migration. They held their own meeting in the homes of one of the Sahaba. And they were of the opinion that the leadership of the community most properly belonged to them, because they felt it was they who had given refuge to the Muslims during the hour of the need. And they were the ones who had taken part in most of the battles. They felt they were the army of Allah, if you would. Whereas they felt that the Muhajirun were only like a brigade in the army of Allah. That was their opinion. So they were gathered together in the homes of one of the Sahabas, and they were discussing how to elect one of their own to the leadership of the community. Upon hearing this, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar, they go to that house, that home, where this gathering is taking place, and the speeches are being made as to why it is that the Ansar deserve the leadership of the community. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq stands up and he tells the Ansar, "We, the Muhajirun, people of Quraysh, we are the most respected in Arabia. We are the most numerous in Arabia. And even the Quran affirms the fact that the first amongst the believers were those from Mecca, from the ones who accepted and followed the Prophet ﷺ. Then the Ansar, and then who came after them." And he also says, "Not only are we the most numerous, we are the closest to the Prophet ﷺ by kinship. We were the first ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself emphasizes the preeminence of the Quraysh, our people, amongst the believers." Now that also needs thinking. One has to ask oneself, everything that the Sahaba did in the early stages after the passing away of the Prophet Muhammad has deep meanings in it. If you think about what Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq said, he emphasizes, first of all, the preeminence of faith. We were the first ones to accept Islam. Faith is the glue that holds a civilization together. This is another thing for the young people to remember. There are only three ways a civilization moves forward. If you ask yourself, what are the engines of a civilization? Most of the time, you find only one of these three. Number one, faith. Where there is no faith, there is no civilization. The second one is contract. The American civilization is based upon contract. And the third one is community. You're my brother, you're my tribe, whatever. These are the three ways a civilization is held together. So, in his presentation to the Ansar, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq first emphasizes the preeminence of faith. We were the first ones to accept Islam. Secondly, he emphasizes the community. We are the closest to the Prophet ﷺ because we are his family. Third, he also emphasizes the fact that we are the most numerous. And then we are the most respected because we are righteous. Then, holding the hands of Abu Bakr Siddiq and another Sahaba who seated on to his other side, he, as Abu Bakr Siddiq, says, "Either of these two are acceptable to us as the Khalifa, as the next leader of the Islamic community." Now ask yourself, you see, what is going on here is the following. They're trying to answer the question as we do today in management, for instance, who, what, how, why, all of these questions being asked, and they're answering them. Who is to be the leader? What is the process of selection of the leadership? What are the responsibilities of the leader? All of these questions are being solved while the body of the Prophet lay in state, if you would, in his own home. Very dire circumstances. Again, ask yourself, if you were there, what would you do? Upon which Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, he stands up and taking the hand of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, he says, "O Abu Bakr, did not the Prophet appoint you to lead the prayer during his last days? And did he not pray behind you? Does it not show that he chose you for the leadership of the community? You are the most righteous," that was the speech amongst us, "and therefore you deserve to be the leader of our community. You deserve to be the Khalifa." At that time, all the Ansar and those Muhajirin who were there, one by one, they come in and take the bayah. Bayah is the oath of allegiance. It was like a, if you want to understand, it was like a town hall meeting. One way to understand, like a town hall meeting where people have different opinions and they were not like timid the way we are today. Our young people don't speak up. When even we tell them, that they don't speak up. Our people don't speak up. We have forgotten how to speak. We must speak up. They were not like that. So imagine a meeting in which everyone has an opinion, and they're very strong opinions, and out of this process emerges a consensus. The first application of the process of ijma, a principle of fiqh. The first application of the process of ijma. The first application of the process of shura in the absence of the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ used to consult with the Sahaba. Now here, the Prophet is not there and the Sahaba are continuing the process of consultation. You may call it democratic. Of course, not everyone is voting, but it is a democratic, it's a consultative process. It is not one person imposing his will upon other people. Very important. The principles that were established. So now you have an affirmation of the continuity of Islam as a historical endeavor. Namely, Islam is going to be based on Tawheed, not based upon one man, that is the Prophet ﷺ. Even though he was the Prophet, Islam is not based upon the Prophet. Islam is based upon Tawheed. Islam is based upon the teachings of the Quran and the unity and the uniqueness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Principle of Tawheed, not the principle of a personality. These are the hidden lessons inherent in the decision that was made there. But this process did not quite satisfy everybody. Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, who was busy preparing the body of the Prophet for burial, because he was family. He was the cousin of the Prophet. He was not there. Some of the other Sahaba, like Talha and Zubair, were not there at the meeting that took place wherein Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq was elected. So that decision was not quite satisfactory to the group that felt that Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu ought to be, should be the Khalifa after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they based their position upon some of the sayings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And in here, you have to be a scholar to follow the thread. All I'm going to do is to expose you to how these differences came about. I'm not taking any positions. We are not hukam. We are not making any decisions, we are not choosing sides, but we ought to be aware as to how it happened. So the group that felt that Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu was to be the Khalifa, because the Prophet has said, Ali is the doorway to my knowledge. And upon his return from the last Hajj at a place called Qadr-e-Khawm, He did say, I leave behind with you the Quran and my family to respect. Of course, he had also said in the plain of Arafah, I leave behind the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So you see the differences in here. People who believed that the selection of the Khalifa, selection of the person who was to lead the community after the Prophet, should be based upon the Sunnah of the Prophet and the Ijma of the community, versus the group that felt it should be based upon some other sayings of the Prophet ﷺ and the spiritual message that is inherent in the statement that Ali is the doorway to my knowledge. However, historically, the so-called Shia-Sunni differences were quiescent, were controlled. They were under the ground, if you would. During the Khilafat of Hazrat Omar, Hazrat Abu Bakr, and Hazrat Usman radiallahu anhu, it was only after the assassination of Hazrat Usman that they came out into the open. They were not in the open up until that time for almost 21, 22 years. These are historical facts. And there was yet another opinion for who ought to be the Khalifa. The Khalifa is not just a temporal figure, because the Prophet ﷺ was not just a temporal leader. He was not just a social leader, a political leader. He was the spiritual pole of his times. He was the spiritual leader. And this position that is taken by those who subscribe to the spiritual view of Islam, the Sufis, is the following. They say, this is the fourth position. I'm exposing you to the entire spectrum of ideas so that you understand where these differences came from. The Sufis feel that it is the spirit that rules, not the body. And the person who is the Khalifa should be the spiritual head of the community. They feel that every age, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appoints a person or sends a person who acts as a spiritual pole, the so-called Qutb. When a prophet is alive, at the time of a prophet, the prophet is the spiritual pole. At the time of Nuh alayhi salam, Noah alayhi salam, he was the pole. At the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was the pole. At the time of Musa alayhi salam, he was the pole. At the time of Isa alayhi salam, he was the pole, the spiritual pole. At the time of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi salam, he was the spiritual pole around which revolved the spiritual dimension of humankind. So they, those who believe that the Khalifa is the spiritual head of the community, less so this temporal head of the community, they say that after the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, that passed on to Hazrat Fatima al-Zahra, because she was the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. And only after Hazrat Fatima al-Zahra passed away, about 6 months after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, did Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu finally give his bayah to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. There are different narratives as to when Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu gave his bayah to Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. Ibn Kathir states that it took him 6 months. Other chroniclers, other historians maintain that it took him 40 days. But the reason is this, the reason is not temporal. The reason is not that he was hesitant. The reason is that we have these different ways of looking at this grand enterprise of Islam. Namely, that the leadership of the community is not just temporal, it's not just social, it is not just military, it's not just legal. It is also spiritual. And they say, primarily, we are a spiritual community, and therefore, the pole passed on from the Prophet to Hazrat Fatima al-Zahra, and after her passing away, it stayed with Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu in support of that, the point of the fact that even when Hazrat Ali was not the Khalifa, during the Khilafat of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar and Hazrat Osman, and even during the period of Muawiyah, the legal decisions used to be referred to Hazrat Ali. If you want to understand Maliki Fiqh, I'll go into it some detail. If you want to understand Maliki Fiqh, you must study the rulings of Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, because most of Maliki Fiqh is based upon the rulings of Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu at the time, at the period of Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, historically. So these were the four different opinions. Thus, the great Islamic community embarked on its historical journey with the assertion of the principle of ijma on the base of a majority, but the principle that the leadership properly belonged to the family of the Prophet through Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, a minority opinion, which in later years became solidified. And because of the warfares and the differences that emerged in later centuries, became hardened. And even to this day, this crack, this Shia Sunni crack, runs like a mighty earthquake crack through Islamic body politic. And even to this day, it shows up. Historically, it showed up during Karbala. It showed up during the Battle of Shaldiran in 1517. It showed up in recent times in the Iran-Iraq War in 1979. It runs even today. That's the origin. The important thing for the young people to remember is that the Shia-Sunni split is not religious. It is based upon history. It is based upon the experience of the community. There is no religious difference. Unfortunately, most people don't take it that way. They are married to history. They're married to the process that is enunciated, that is described to them by some people for obvious reasons of self-interest, and then they become hardened in their opinions. And not only do they get hardened, they fight over it. So in conclusion, what are some of the lessons we have in this process? First of all, we see the passing away of the greatest man who ever lived, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Death is a sign. Death is a sign. You will die and I will die. Everyone will die. Death is a sign. Kullu man alayha fan wa yabqa wajhu rabbika dhal jalali wal ikram. It was recited during the Salat today. Upon everything there shall be annihilation. We shall die. Death is a sign. We must learn from it. What are the lessons from death? Infinite number of lessons. That's number one. Secondly, Islam is an existential religion. It's a big word for the young people. It means it has a certain potential. And that potential comes into being through the efforts of the community. The community is an existential community. It has to continue the process of creating the edifice of Islam, the structure of Islam, in history through that efforts, unceasing. Every generation, you, all of you, us, we have to create the edifice using the principles of the Quran. That's the guidance from the Quran. And the guidance from the Sunnah of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, each generation must rediscover the truth that is promised to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when He says, I will show you my signs on the horizon and within your own souls until you have certainty of truth. All of our life is a search for the truth. Haq is a big word. Haq is the name of Allah. So you can interpret that ayah to mean It is a search for the presence of Allah. Haq means justice. You can interpret the ayah to mean all of life is a struggle to find justice. Justice, fundamental principle, means rights and responsibilities. Men, women, children, different communities, different nations, nationalities. You can say that life is a struggle to find justice. Each word of the Quran is like that. So, the second lesson that we have in there is the lesson of ijma, namely the process of consultation and a continuous renewal of faith through the process of implementing ijma. That is the collective opinion of the community. To expand upon that, I'll just take a few minutes so the young people grasp onto the ideas. For instance, suppose you go to the North Pole and there is nobody there except that you find one Muslim. Imagine, you're near the North Pole, there's only one Muslim, and this one Muslim prays facing a certain direction. And you think he's facing the wrong direction. Ijma connotes that you follow him. That's his domain. When he visits somebody's home, the man of the house is the imam. You follow him. He's the leader. Unless he asks you to lead the prayer, you don't do that. He's the leader. You honor it. Principle of ijma, which is so important in at least the sunnah schools of fiqh. We'll go over that. The third sign that we see in here is the opinion of minority and majority. There was the minority opinion. It existed side by side with the majority opinion for 21 years. It was only upon the fitna that arose, upon the assassination of Hazrat Osman ibn Affan, that it came into the open. Lastly, the signs of division that we encounter, that we experience even in today's world, the so-called Shia Sunni one. It has no basis in religion. It has its basis only in history. It is okay to disagree about history. We do not disagree about the Quran. We do not disagree about the Prophet ﷺ. But it's okay to disagree about history, take different positions, and still find it possible to exercise that collective opinion. Lastly, if you're a student of history and sociology and political movements, the position that came out of Allama Iqbal in the 19th century, the beginning of 19th century, in his reconstruction of religious thought in Islam, the position that was offered by the poet Zia at the time of Kamal Ataturk, the position that was offered by Ali Shariati just before the Iranian Revolution, all of these have their basis on the principle of ijma, even though in Iran the ijma is not the ijma of the community, it's the ijma of the scholars who are authorized to do so. But the principle is accepted. That is by way of an introduction to what happened at the time of the passing away of the greatest man who ever lived, our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, I'll listen to you and ask you for your inputs and your opinions and your questions, and we can learn from each other. Yes, sir.
A couple of things that come to mind, and of course there are different views in this matter, but one example, I think it was during the Battle of Badr or Uhud, you can correct me which one, that there was a conversation, should the community remain in Medina to defend the city or to go out to face the enemy? And I think the consultation took place, and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, agreed upon the situation. suggestion to perhaps go out. Am I, first of all, speaking in the right context, or am I misinformed?
Let me understand the question and maybe then.
Okay. So if what I'm saying is correct, then that would be a clear demonstration on the part of the Prophet that mutual consultation is important, and even if your opinion may not be exactly the same as perhaps the majority, then based on the democratic process, that is acceptable. And then I think in the Quran also Allah tells us that in all important matters, make decisions by mutual consultations, and once you have decided, then trust in Allah and carry forward and stay firm and resolute.
Correct. Your observations are correct qualitatively. It's immaterial when it happened. The important things that you pointed out, number one, that is based upon the Quran, also based upon the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, in as much as the Prophet ﷺ was constantly consulting with the Sahaba. There are so many instances. For instance, one time when people asked him about how to take care of date trees, the Prophet offered a solution. It did not quite work out, upon which the Prophet ﷺ said, "That's just my opinion." At the time of the battle of the trench, he consulted with the Sahaba, and the Sahaba said, "That's Salman Farsi. He recommended digging a trench." And that was not known at the time in Arabia. So the Prophet ﷺ, through his own example, showed the preeminence of ijma, that is consultation, as he did on many other occasions, the preeminence of knowledge. We'll talk about that during one of the other sessions. So your observations are sound, consultation, and if we want to use the word democracy, I don't want to do it because it has many other connotations, is based upon the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet. And once there is a consensus, then it's obligatory on our part to give counsel, but to follow it.
So you said Shia position, basically, and the Sufi position is similar on how to select a Khalifa, how they should.
No, the
difference is Sufi believe that Hazrat Fatima was Zahra, first one, and then Ali. But the Shia believe that Ali is the first one, right? Mm-hmm. So basically, it's a similar, right?
Not quite. The Shia position is that the leadership of the community should rest with the family of the Prophet ﷺ, Ahl al-Bayt. The Sufi position is that the leadership of the community should rest with the most spiritual person of the age. The two are not the same. But in that case, they coalesced. They were the same because the most spiritual person after Hazrat Fatima al-Zahra was Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, and most Sufi tariqas, they trace the lineage to Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu. Ahl al-Bayt, spiritual. Sir.
So you said that the decision to appoint a Khalifa was based on Ijma. So, you know, what does Ijma mean in that case? Because obviously if a major Sahabi like Hazrat Ali was not consulted, and Hazrat Zubair and Hazrat Talha were not consulted, then is that ijma?
Well, that's a good point. This is exactly what is being debated for 1500 years. Exactly. This is exactly what is being debated. Was that ijma? That's a good question. Let me take it to the next higher level. The ijma that was implemented was the ijma of some, but not all of the Sahaba. In the Hanafi fiqh, if you study fiqh, ijma is the ijma of some of the Sahaba. If some of the Sahaba made a decision, that is acceptable in the Hanafi fiqh. Whereas in the Maliki fiqh, it requires the ijma of all of the Sahaba, much more strict. So what they did, what happened at that time, became the basis for the principles of fiqh 100 years later. Very good question. That is still what is being debated. We, 1500 years later, do not take a position on that, because each of the positions, though they were not ordinary men. The Sahaba were not ordinary people. They were extraordinary people with extraordinary abilities. So we cannot be in a position of judgment. We should know what happened. We should understand why it is that people disagree on the basis of history. And then we have to find ways of working for the common good, even though our understanding of history and our own understanding of what should have happened at the time may be different from the opinion of other people. Good point. That's still being debated.
You used the term existentialism.
Yes.
Which I could not understand, to be very frank. This term was used by Jean-Paul Sartre of France. He was a great philosopher of France, and he used this term existentialism. But this is so abstract and metaphysical that I cannot understand.
What Ali Shariati, who was unfortunately assassinated, explained it in Islamic terms. What Ali Shariati, one of the greatest incisive thinkers that I've come across, along with Alim Iqbal and Zia and others, he says existentialism just means that existence, the potential, precedes the becoming of it. Namely, for instance, I may have the potential to become a great doctor, but I'm not a great doctor. I work towards it, take the exams, and I go to college, and et cetera, go to Harvard, and go through process, and so on and so forth, and through effort, one day, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if Allah so wills it, I do become a doctor. The potential and the becoming. The potential and the becoming. That's the way Ali Shariati explains it, and that's the way I accept it from an Islamic perspective. In as much as Islam still has this great potential, but look at the position that we are in.
No.
That's what it is.
Thank you.
Sir.
I have two questions. One is, like you said, Shia and Sunni is not religious. It's
No, I didn't say that.
It's mostly politically.
Please repeat that.
The difference between Shia and Sunni is mostly political, right?
Historical.
Historical.
Not political. Historical.
Historical, but not religious.
Not religious, no.
And the violence and all this going on in the Muslim world is mostly political.
Political.
Right? And the other question is about ijma. Since Muslims, we don't have popes or ministers or anything like that, but ijma, is this still being practiced?
Well, good question. You have to answer it yourself. I'll give you an example of how, see, what happens is that when you have a great idea and you try to implement it in the matrix of human affairs, it becomes corrupt. You may have a great idea about how to swim, for instance, but the moment somebody enters a swimming pool, it becomes like a mud pool. That's the real world, dunya. So what happened in the case of Allama Iqbal's concept? He, too, recommended the principle of ijma, based upon which he felt that the Muslims of the subcontinent should exercise their right to build a community consistent with the guidance of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet. It was implemented. Is it being implemented in Pakistan? No. So the answer to your question is obvious. Each one of us has to answer it. Unfortunately, I will make this statement for the young people. We, first of all, this is my submission to everyone, do not read the Quran, first of all. I'm amazed as to why we refuse to read it. We'll read about the Quran, we'll read about Islam, we'll read about politics, we'll read about everything, but we don't want to study the Quran. I will study it 3 days, 4 days, somebody passed away. We are done. We must study the Quran, understand it, understand the guidance, and also understand the wisdom in the decisions that were made by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His methodology, not exactly what he did, because that was specific to the context of the times, but what was his methodology? And if we take those two, then our existential potential is with the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We don't. We do everything else. We'd rather fight than learn. There was one other question from one of the sisters that I'll come back.
Do we forget the one thing that if Allah wanted Hazrat Ali to be the leader, he would have done that. But why don't people, you know, be content with the decision? That's all.
Well, that's. You know, it's a tough one to answer. You know, when you talk to the Christians, let me make it controversial so that we have some fun. When you talk to the Christians, they say to us Muslims, well, if Allah wants to become a human being, why can't he do that? But you see, the thing is that we are studying history, namely from the point of view of how people, the Sahabas were human beings. They are not prophets. No. Only the Prophet was the Prophet. The Sahaba were great human beings, but they were human beings. How did they implement the guidance of the Quran and the guidance of the Prophet in the matrix of human affairs, considering the situation in Arabia at the time? And what can we learn from it? As signs, so that we become a little wiser. So it's hard to answer a statement like if Allah wanted it, you know, of course Allah can do it. I will come back to you. Yes, sir.
I'm trying to wrap my head around this word ijtihad. Now, in the history of Islam, is it true that 1,000 years back ijtihad stopped? And where did it live? Like, what stage did ijtihad from? Ijma, ijtihad, and then it was frozen.
Very good question. Inshallah, we'll cover that in great detail. First of all, ijtihad comes from the word jahada, meaning a strenuous intellectual exercise to apply the guidance of the Quran and Sunnah of the Prophet to the issues, the problems that we face. That is what ijtihad is. Did ijtihad stop? Well, that's a very good question. Functionally, yes, this, you know, people became followers, taqlid. They stopped asking, they stopped. Science is a good example. I'll talk about it in one of my talks as to what happened to science. They said, this is the will of Allah. And therefore, they did not ask the scientists. They stopped asking what. They don't ask what is the will of Allah. Yas'aluhu man fis samawati wal earth. Everything that is between the heavens and the earth asks of him. Why is it that we don't ask? Everything. The ant asks, the bird asks, the atom asks, the hurricane, whatever. In other words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there to answer. As'al bihi khabira, ask of him who knows. Quotation from the Quran. So we must ask, we forgot how to ask. And we forgot how to have differences of opinion and still find common ground to work together. No, it has to be my way or the highway. No, I'm the authority. Sir.
Thank you. In the Quran we read that Allah Ta'ala addressing Prophet Ibrahim mentioned that I'm going to assign you as a leader for mankind.
Imam, yes.
Imam. And he asked, does it also apply to my descendants? And Allah responded, not to those who are unrighteous. So that ayah or the verse from the Quran itself clearly shows that the spiritual excellence of guidance is not necessarily a matter of inheritance. It is a gift that Allah spreads amongst humans wherever. The The other point is that in the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, whenever he undertook a mission, whether it was trade, diplomatic, religious, spreading the word of Allah, military, he almost always chose various leaders, depending on what he felt were their skill sets and what the mission required. That in itself, as part of the Sunnah, teaches us that leadership is also not the right of inheritance. It is a matter of the community using their good judgment to find individuals who have the necessary skills for the job at hand to be the most effective to carry it forward.
That's certainly the Sunnah position. That's the position of the four schools of Sunnah. These are the things. On the other hand, if we discuss this issue with our Shia brothers, they point out to another passage in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I will cleanse the Ahl al-Bayt. In other words, I'll make them cleanse, meaning from a spiritual perspective. And they say the Ahl al-Bayt have been cleansed, and therefore they are entitled to the spiritual leadership of the Islamic community. They, I'm not arguing in here. I'm just presenting the different points of view so that we, as Muslims in America, learn to respect the opinions that they have from a historical point of view. They also point out the hadith wherein the Prophet ﷺ said, Ali is the doorway to my knowledge. Confirm hadith. So they say that proves, and then of course there is the hadith also wherein they point out that on the way back from the Hajj, the Prophet ﷺ stopped at Ghadir Qaum and he said, I leave behind the Quran and my family. And by the family, they mean Hazrat Fatima al-Zahra, Hazrat Ali, Hassan Hussein, in his chadur, if you would. That's what they offer. We should be aware of it.
Right.
Our position is that this is what it is. But we should be aware, and we should respect the other man's opinion too. That's a historical thing. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the most flexible of people. We know that even in prayer, some people, you know, hold their hands here, some people don't. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like that. In recitations, even in Surah Al-Fatiha, you know, you see differences. Malik and Malik, whereas the Africans and North Africans, Malik, whereas when they take the Hibs type of pronunciation, it's Malik. The Prophet ﷺ was the most flexible of human beings. He was like a tent, if you would, that accommodated so many different opinions within him. He was like an ocean. Ocean of oceans, if you would. What has happened to us is that we forgot the ocean. We say, well, the water that I have collected from the ocean in my hand is the only one. So your point is well taken. It's correct. But that's one opinion.
What is the meaning of the word al-bayt that you use the word? I don't understand.
Al-bayt is the family of the Prophet.
Oh, okay.
Can you please repeat the definition of ishtiyaq?
It comes, the root word is jahada, jim, hay, dal, jahada. It means struggle. It's a generic word. That's the jihad is one of the words that springs from jahada, to struggle. And the struggle does not necessarily mean the way jihad is understood, or even istihad is understood. Even if a student is working hard in a classroom, we say, Jahada Ibrahimu alal madrasa. Ibrahim studying hard in the school. So that's the root meaning of it. In this context, it means a strenuous intellectual exercise to apply the guidance of the Quran and the seerah of the Prophet ﷺ to the issues at hand. I chose my words very carefully, and those are important. The Sira and the guidance. One last question, and inshallah we'll call it today. One last one. Or a comment. Yes, sir.
So how can you say that the differences between Shia and Sunni are not religious? I mean, there are some clear differences in doctrine. I mean, of course, there are brothers, but there are some clear differences.
Please expand on it.
I mean, the whole concept of imams. Right? They take, their rulings based on, the whole concept of, the masoom, the error-freeness of an imam.
Good question. Islam means, young people, Islam is the Quran and the Sira of the Prophet. That is Islam. What happens after that is history. The imamate, the khilafat, even the principles of fiqh that have evolved since then. These are historical attempts on the part of Muslims to implement the guidance of the Quran and the Sira of the Prophet in the matrix of history. So what has happened to us is that Islam has become a religion of history. But Islam is the Quran, the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Sunnah and the Sira of the Prophet. So if we take it in a generic sense, anyone who follows the guidance of the Quran and the Sira of the Prophet is a Muslim. And everything else, imamate, all of the discussions and the debates and the killings and wars that have gone on, historical. Islam, unfortunately, has become a prisoner of history. We must extricate ourselves. We must extricate ourselves from history. We must extricate ourselves from history.
But if I may comment on his question.
Sir.
Islam is true, it's from Quran and Sira. However, when Shias come and Islam says you only go back to this Quran and Sira for your rulings. So Shia have the notion of saying their Ayatollah, their Imam is Masoom. Means he's error-free, he can create his own rulings above and beyond the Quran and Shia and the Sunnah. That's where we say this is not Islamic, whereby they're going beyond what the Quran and the Sunnah ordered us to do. So from that aspect, it is a religious deviation. And from that, kind of, when they allow the Ayatollah to create his own ruling, it's putting him at the stage of a prophet. And the Sunnah scholars said that the Ahmadiyya are infidels because they added one prophet in a way. So what about the Shia who added multiple prophets? Because everyone to them is a prophet. Because the prophet, the definition of a prophet is the one who gives you extra rulings, right, above and beyond the Quran and Sunnah. Right. So from that aspect, we say it's religious.
Inshallah, we'll meet next week.
Thank you.
Come back with comments, questions, think about it. Think. That's most important.